Well, I want to welcome you now back to our study of the Gospel of John. We're actually in section 6. And in this section, we're going to be looking at another powerful theme and literary style in the Gospel of John. We've mentioned so far clearly that John has a purpose, John 20, 30, and 31, that Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. But John says, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life in his name. Now, we've also noticed that John does not approach his gospel by a strictly chronological point of view. He's looking at it thematically. A few of the literary styles that we notice in John is what we've termed under the theme scene select, where John has these seven miraculous signs. He has these this grouping of unique I am statements, you know, bread of life and way, the truth, and the life, the door, shepherd, so on. But another one we've mentioned is the powerful use of interpersonal conversations that John uses to reveal Jesus. We noted, for instance, at one time that where Matthew might record a long sermon and Jesus says something like, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy, John doesn't have that teaching recorded, but in the conversation of Jesus with the woman caught in adultery, clearly that is the lesson that's taught. But it's taught through a conversation, see, through a personal interaction. We might say that blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs are the kingdom of heaven. But see, now, John doesn't actually record that teaching. But when we see the humble way that Jesus interacts with people, especially where John reminds us that Jews have nothing to do with Samaritans except Jesus, who goes into a Samaritan village and actually engages a Samaritan woman who's been through 5 wrecked marriages, then we see the quality that Matthew records as a teaching. We see that same quality recorded in a personal conversation. And of course, the washing of the disciples' feet, you know, would declare the same thing. The other Gospels have Jesus saying that that God brings down the prideful but raises up the humble. So humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he'll exalt you, and so on. So the teaching is you need to be humble. Of course, clearly, John 13, through that interaction, teaches the same lesson. So what I want to do in this session is take one of the most important themes in the Gospel of John and show how it's woven into the interaction with a man named Nicodemus. Now, in our last session, we showed once again that every major theme in the Gospel of John is actually introduced in the prologue, the first 18 verses. So in our last section, we talked about Jesus as the coming one, the one who comes into the world from God, intercepting the world in its path of destruction and forever changing the world for the better. It is through the coming one, the Word who becomes flesh, the bread of life coming down from heaven, that we experience the intersection between that which is from above and that which is from below. Remember that Tom Wright in John for Everyone described Jesus as a ladder, hearkening back to the experience that Jacob had when he also had this interaction with God. That's referenced in John chapter 3. And so we have this idea that Jesus is somehow the connection between heaven and earth. So we're reminded that Jesus is from above. He's come to earth. He is teaching us who are from below to look higher, to think higher, to understand that really we're here for something more than just this earth. So when Jesus feeds the multitudes with bread, he says to them, don't get lost in the miracle of the bread. I am the bread. I am the bread that comes down from heaven. when Jesus is with a woman at the well, and she's there to get water. He asks for a cup of water. He says to her, "You realize, if you knew who I was, you would ask me for water. The water I give you would well up unto eternal life." So everything in John is kind of this sign, this signpost that points us from something earthly to something heavenly. Okay? Now, the theme then that we want to look at now in the prologue is found in John chapter 1, and let's begin reading in verse 10. This is talking about Jesus, the Word who became flesh. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which is his own, but his own did not receive him. Now this is verse 12. "Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave them the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of a human decision or of a husband's will, but born of God." So this theme in the prologue is that those who believe in Jesus are going to experience a birth. They are his own people. But when they believe in Jesus, in some way, they experience a birth. So let's look at John chapter 3. In John 3, we have this famous experience, and I'm going to read verses 1 down through 11. "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. He was a member of the Jewish ruling council." Now let's stop there for a moment. These Pharisees, they come up all the time in the Gospels. So who are these guys? Normally, they're kind of the folks that we think of as the bad guys. But the Pharisees actually started in the second century before Christ. And they were what we might call a restoration movement, kind of a turn people back to God movement. In American history, we might refer to them as a revivalist movement. The idea was the Pharisees, the name means set apart. They believed that the religious condition of Israel prior to Jesus, second century BC, was ungodly. That there was national fervor, but not the kind of spiritual fervor that needed to be happening. The Pharisees poured themselves into the scrolls, the Word of God. They not only studied the Word of God, but they sought to apply the Word of God. They weren't received well by everyone because their revivalist teaching got on the nerves of some of the political leaders. At different times in history, several hundred Pharisees were actually martyred, crucified. But by the time of Jesus, the Pharisees had a lot more footing in society. They were more popular. They had great influence. Now, to make sure we understand, not all Pharisees were bad guys. You realize that the man who becomes the Apostle Paul is a Pharisee. So there were many Pharisees, according to Acts 15, who became disciples of Jesus. So the Pharisees, don't assume they're all bad. However, the Pharisees are butting heads against Jesus all the time throughout his ministry. Part of the reason is because they were now settled in positions of influence and power. Jesus was upsetting the balance of power, so many of the Pharisees didn't believe him, turned against him, even sought to persecute him. Well, Nicodemus is an exception. He's a Pharisee. Also, Nicodemus is a member of the Jewish ruling council, or the Sanhedrin. I've heard people compare them to the Supreme Court like the U.S. Supreme Court. And, you know, that's okay, but it's limiting because they had a different kind of responsibility for the Jews. But maybe it is fair to say that this Sanhedrin ruling council, that they had both religious, spiritual, social, cultural, political decision-making power among the people of Israel. So John wants to make it clear that Nicodemus is a part of these Pharisees and a part of the Jewish ruling council. So, you know, that would say a lot of things about Nicodemus socially, perhaps even economically, educationally. But John wants us to know where this guy is coming from. So let's continue reading. Verse 2, he came to Jesus at night. Now, depending on how old you are, you might remember Nick at night. That's a way to remember this guy. So he came to Jesus at night and he said, Rabbi, which means teacher, of course, we know you are a teacher who has come from God. See, there's that reference to that theme we had in the last section. We know you're a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miraculous signs you are doing if God were not with him. Now, that's packed, isn't it? What is John's purpose? You know, remember what he stated? The reason that I picked these miraculous signs is so that you could believe that Jesus is the Christ. What does he quote Nicodemus as saying? No one could do the miraculous signs you're doing if God were not with them. See, this all feeds into the purpose of John's witness. Now, in reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Now, I don't know how that strikes you, but it's a little odd to me because it says that Jesus answered Nicodemus, but it didn't sound like Nicodemus asked a question. Yeah, Jesus does this other places, but I just want to concentrate on this. Nicodemus says, hey, we, verse 2, know you are a teacher who has come from God. Who is the we and what is the setting Nicodemus is giving us a peek into? He's had to have a discussion with somebody. So was it other people from the Jewish ruling council? Was it family members? My guess is that it's probably some of his peers, maybe even other Pharisees or somebody on the Jewish ruling council. But he's met with somebody and they've been saying, okay, what do you make of this Jesus guy? Man, well, did you hear about the miracle? Yeah. Yeah, I mean like that turning water to wine thing. Yes. What do you think? Goodness. Who could do that if they weren't from God? Did you hear about him clearing the temple? Yeah, I heard about that too. Boy, that's scary stuff. You know, not sure that we feel that good about it. Somebody else says, yes, but if he is from God, maybe the temple needed to be cleared. I don't know what all constituted their conversation, but we know that because he says, we know. They've talked among themselves. Now, I don't know where the rest of the we is, because they're not with Nicodemus then. Nicodemus is there by himself. And again, my guess is that they had that conversation somewhere else. And Nicodemus probably said something like, well, let's go talk to him. And they were like, you go talk to him, you're on your own. Or maybe he didn't volunteer that he was going to go talk to him, but he just had to. So he shows up under the cover of darkness, the privacy of night. He initiates this conversation and says, Jesus, you've got to be from God. Your miracles prove it. And Jesus says, you need to be born again if you want to see the kingdom of heaven. Now, they longed to see the kingdom of heaven. They longed to see the reign of God. Remember we said in the previous session that many people, not just Jews, we're longing for an anticipated one, a prophet, king figure. Jesus is the coming one who many people said he fits the bill, as we read in our last session. He fits the bill as the prophet that would come. He fits the bill as the Christ. Others disagreed. Nicodemus says, you got to be from God. Jesus says, if you want to see the kingdom, if you're one of those waiting for the kingdom, you'll have to be born again. Now, the phrase born again can just as easily be translated born from above. And remember, what's the theme? That these people in John chapter 1 who believe in Jesus, they're not born from below. Genealogy, husband decision, human will, they're born of God. So being born from above fits that theme from chapter 1. So when you're born from above, it must mean that something is fundamentally changing about you. But now watch what happens. Verse 4. So how can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. Now notice, this is a theme in John, right? Above and below. Nicodemus is thinking about birth only from earthly terms. He might be saying, hey, I know my mom. There's no sense in even talking to my mom about this. Actually, I think he's making a general statement. Clearly, there's no way to physically redo birth. So Jesus says again in verse 5. So Jesus answers him, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he's born of water and spirit. So whatever born from above means in verse 3, he clarifies born of water and spirit in verse 5. Then notice what he says in verse 6. You see, here's the issue. Verse 6. Flesh gives birth to flesh. So that's the earthly view. The spirit gives birth to spirit. So that's the view from above. So he says in verse 7, you shouldn't be surprised at my saying you must be born again. Born from above. The wind, and this is a play on words I'll explain in a moment. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. Now, here's the play on words. The first part of your Bible, the Old Testament, is primarily written in Hebrew. The second part of your Bible, the New Testament, is written in Koine Greek. Okay? In both languages, the word for spirit, pneuma in Greek and ruach in Hebrew, both of those, the word for spirit is also the word for breath. It's the word for air and the word for wind. So the Greek word pneuma, we get that word into English today, pneumatic. So a pneumatic ball, a pneumatic tire is a ball or a tire that's filled with air. It's pneumatic. You see on a roadside crew, a jackhammer, they call those a pneumatic hammer because they're run by air. In a shop, a mechanic shop, you'll hear an air tool like a air, and it's called a pneumatic tool, a pneumatic wrench because it's run by air. Some of you have had like a pellet gun or something, it's called a pneumatic rifle because it's an air rifle or a rifle where you pump up air and then fire it. So pneumatic means air, or, you know, in their terms, the word pneuma meant air, wind, breath, or spirit. So when he says you got to be born of the Spirit, he gives this illustration and he says, see, it's kind of like the wind. You know the presence of the wind, but you're not the one that generated it, and you're not the one that says where it's going. You didn't bring it and you didn't send it. The wind comes at will from somewhere else and goes at will somewhere else. So he says the person that's been born from above, it's not done in an earthly transaction. It doesn't matter if you were physically born of a certain ethnicity. Doesn't matter who your daddy is, so to speak. What it means is that you've been born of God. So if you want to be a part of the kingdom of God, which they were waiting on, the inbreaking of God's rule, if you want to be a part of the kingdom of God, then you must be born of God, born again, born from above, born of the Spirit. Now notice he said in verse 5, water and Spirit. So let me take a minute and address that. Some people have tried to say that the water there represents the water like of the womb. Like when we talk about a woman previous to birth, her water breaks, that this is the water of the womb representing physical birth, and that the Spirit represents the spiritual birth. I understand kind of that line of reasoning. It doesn't fit with the Gospel of John at all. So I want to take a moment and point that out in the context of this passage. Verse 5 is actually another way of stating verse 3, and then verse 7 looks back on verses 5 and 3. So in verse 3, what does it say? You've got to be born from above. What does it say in verse 7? You've got to be born from above. What does he say in verse 5? If you want to see the kingdom, just like verse 3, you got to be born of water and Spirit. There is a literary tool popular in Hebrew literature called parallelism. The idea is what you state in one sentence is restated in a following sentence in some way. So it can restate it in an opposite way, it can restate it in an identical way, or in parallelism, the second statement can actually add definition to the first statement. So you might say, God is my rock, he is my fortress and my refuge. So rock, first sentence, of course we get that, you know, sturdy, stability, the metaphor for that, safety. But fortress and refuge add something to the first statement. So verse 3, you must be born again, is defined better by verse 5, by water and Spirit. Now, we don't need to get thrown off by this. Probably, it makes sense in the Gospel of John and in the New Testament that the born of water is actually the speaking of baptism. This should not surprise us one bit. Water baptism shouldn't surprise us at all. Here's why. Number one, water baptism was practiced among the Jews. This was not new with Jesus. It wasn't new with John the Baptist. It wasn't new with the early church. This was a practice already among the Jews. You may have heard of a famous set of scrolls called the Dead Sea Scrolls. They were discovered in 1947, southwest of Jerusalem, over by the Dead Sea, hence the name, around a community called Qumran. I've been there a few times. Maybe you have as well. Fascinating place. There were caves where an early community, religious community, the Essenes, E-S-S-E-N-E-S, had a vibrant community in the first century. These people were practicing to the best of their ability the core of what they believed it meant to be God's people. I've been to this community where the archaeological dig is. I've been all through it several times. Throughout this community, there are baptistries. The baptistries are interesting. The baptistries would be a pool, a kind of a larger pool, maybe, I don't know, 10 feet by 10 feet, 8 feet by 8 feet, maybe some of them as deep as this table, maybe a little more shallow. And there would be two sets of stairs, one going down in, one coming up out. And what the baptism signified was, you go down into the water one way, you come up out of the water another way, okay? So among the Essenes, they could do several baptisms per day for cleansing. In John 3, remember, there's a discussion concerning baptism about ceremonial cleansing in chapter 3. And so for them to go down into the water several times a day for ceremonial cleansing, for them to be cleansed for the next religious practice. In Old Jerusalem, I've also been to the baptistries excavated there, not far from the Western Wall. It is the same thing, going down in, coming up out. You go down carrying this burden of sin or filth, like moral filth. You come up purified. So we should not be surprised at all that John the Baptist incorporates water baptism for repentance, preparing the way for the Messiah. We should not be surprised that Jesus' disciples baptized, John 3. We shouldn't be surprised when we get into the book of Acts that Jesus' disciples are baptizing. This is not new. This is not strange. So the idea that Jesus would say, you must be born again of water and spirit, water baptism already carried the idea of newness, of this fresh beginning, of the old passing away, the new coming, purification. So don't be shocked by a physical act engaging spiritual truth. See, this is part of the problem. Everything in the Gospel of John is a signpost pointing to things above. So baptism in and of itself does nothing. It's only that baptism is pointing the participant by faith to the things of God, what God accomplishes in baptism. Otherwise, it's no more than dipping yourself in water or going for a swim. So the same thing would be true with anything in the Gospel of John. So when he feeds the multitude, he doesn't want them getting hung up on the miracle, though it is physical evidence that Jesus is the prophet like unto Moses. John says that the physical miracles are evidence that Jesus is who he says he is. And what did Nicodemus confess? You couldn't do the miracles you're doing unless you were from God. So the physical points toward what? Spiritual reality. So don't be surprised when God uses or incorporates something physical like baptism in the spiritual reality of rebirth. Now, notice he also says, born of water and spirit. The spirit is what is referenced when it says, this is from God. The wind comes from where? From somewhere else. It goes where? Where you don't know. So it is with everyone. What does it say in verse 9? Everyone born of the spirit. So even though they are incorporating a practice that was already familiar, baptism, the new birth doesn't happen because of the physical water. The new birth only happens because of the operation of God's Spirit. So he wants them to understand, don't get hung up on earthly things. This is about something happening from above, being born anew. Now notice what Nicodemus says in verse 9. Everybody look at verse 9. Ready? How can this be? Now that is the question of the Gospel of John. How can this be? And the answer is always the same. If you look at it through the lens of the earth and earthly things, it can't be. But if you understand that something heavenly is happening, that God has broken into earth in Jesus Christ, the Word became flesh, and that something spiritual is happening, lift your eyes. If you see that, it changes everything. So what does Jesus tell the woman at the well in John 4? He says, if you would ask me for water, where are they sitting? At a physical well. What is she there to get? Physical water. What does Jesus ask her for? Physical water. But what does Jesus say? Look up. If you knew who I was, if you knew who was talking to you, you'd ask me for living water. You see, he uses the physical to point to the spiritual. He uses the earthly to point to the heavenly. He uses the tangible to to point to the eternal or the intangible. Same thing is true at the feeding of the 5,000. Same thing is true at the healing of the blind man. Same thing is true at the healing of Lazarus. Consider this. Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. Did Lazarus ever die physically again? Of course he did. So Jesus raising him physically did not change that Lazarus needed to be born again spiritually. So the physical points to the spiritual, the temporary to the eternal. And so when Nicodemus asked, how can this happen? How can this be? Jesus says, you are Israel's teacher, verse 10, and you don't understand these things? I tell you the truth. We speak of what we know and we testify to what we've seen, but you people still do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak to you of heavenly things? So you see the theme continuing. See, Jesus says, Nicodemus says, there's no way you could do what you're doing if you weren't from God. Now, I want you to think with me about something. It seems to me that Nicodemus doesn't understand the full impact of what he's saying, that you're from God. Well, to Nicodemus, that might mean a godly man. Instead of the prophet, like the one unto Moses, like Moses, it might be you're like a prophet. And not so much like the Christ, but you're like a man of God, right? Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. In chapter 4 later, when Jesus is with the woman at the well, she actually says, we know that one called Messiah is coming. Jesus says, that's me. Well, see, what that indicates is they had this anticipation. She was a Samaritan. They had this anticipation that one like this was coming. But see, it appears as though Nicodemus isn't ready to say, Jesus, you are the prophet, you are the Christ, you are like the Son of God. I think what Nicodemus is ready to say is, you are a godly man. You are clearly from God, like one of the prophets. So when Jesus then stretches Nicodemus and says, okay, Nick, here's the deal. This kingdom you're waiting for, you got to be born again if you want to be a part of it. Born from above. Then notice what he says, and this is so important, verse 3. Look at it. Look at verse 3. If you want to see it, what does that mean? If you want to see it, if you want to recognize it, if you want to comprehend it, if you want to participate in it, you're going to have to look at all of this from another point of view, not the earthly point of view, the heavenly point of view. And when Nicodemus says, well, there's no way you can get back in your mother's womb, Jesus says, that's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about a second earthly birth. We're talking about birth from above. We're talking about being born again of water and spirit. And what did we already say the water represented? It represented the spiritual activity of God. So this is something like the wind. This isn't something you control. It's something you experience. But only God controls it. So all of this is from above. And Nicodemus says, how can this be? And Jesus says, you realize that exposes a problem here. In verse 10. You are the teacher of my people. Please look at verse 10. You are Israel's teacher. Wow. What does that say about Nicodemus? I'm not sure. You're Israel's teacher. How much influence did this guy have? And Jesus says, but Nick, you're the main guy, and you're not looking at it from a heavenly point of view? How are we going to make any progress? That's why Jesus says, I'm telling you, we, meaning Jesus and his followers, we speak from what we know, and we testify to what we've seen. But you, but still you people, Nick and whoever you're talking to, Nicodemus, whoever you're talking to, you still don't accept our testimony. I've spoken you of earthly things, meaning what? I've tried to put this in earthly terms. You're still not getting it. How's it going to go when I switch over to completely heavenly terms, right? Then he says in verse 13, no one's ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven. Now we have the marriage of these two key themes. The theme of the last session, the coming one, and the theme of Jesus being the one who ushers in that which is from above. He says, no one's actually gone into heaven except what is it? Except me, the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Interestingly enough, the Son of Man, that phrase, and we'll study this more later, has a deep history in the prophetic voice of the Old Testament. But this is Jesus's favorite term for himself. It is used over 82 times in the Gospels, Son of Man. Jesus, looking back to this rich metaphor of identity as the coming one of God who comes into God's world and leads people on the path of redemption and restoration. The Son of Man, verse 14, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. So he hearkens back to this event recorded in the book of Numbers, where the people of Israel, because of rebellion, many of them have been struck in a plague, and they pick up, Moses is instructed to take a snake, wrap it around a pole, lift it up among the people. Those who in faith look upon it are healed. Notice again, it's not the physical component that is what you're supposed to focus on. It's a signpost to God. Jesus says that he, in kind of cryptic language, will also be lifted up in such a way that people who look unto him will be born from above. Now, I think the way to think about this that will be helpful for us is that what Jesus is calling us to is to be twice born. We've already been born physically. So have you, you have, so have I. But to be twice born means that we put our faith in God and that we admit that we need God to do something in our life that we can't do for ourselves. We need God's Spirit to take control of our life. We need to put the kind of faith in Christ Jesus that our identity changes from having been born once of a human decision to having been born of Christ, making us disciples of Jesus Christ. The theologian A.W. Tozer says it this way. There is a distinction which we dare to make if we are to think the thoughts of God after him and to bring our beliefs into harmony with the Holy Scriptures. That distinction is the one which exists between two classes of human beings, the once born and the twice born. Now, just who belongs to one class and who to the other is not always possible to judge, though the two kinds of life ordinarily separate from each other. Those who are twice born crystallize around the person of Jesus Christ. They cluster together in companies, meaning in assemblies or what we would call a church family, while the once born are held together only by the ties of nature, aided perhaps by ties of race, common political or social interests. But the difference of moral standards between the once born and the twice born and their opposite ways of life though may be a contributing factor to the hostility between the once born and the twice born, the real cause lies deeper. That is because there are two spirits abroad in the earth. The spirit that works in the children of disobedience and the spirit of God. These two can never be reconciled in time or eternity. The spirit that dwells in the once born is forever opposed to the spirit that inhabits the heart of the twice born. These words of Tozer may be difficult, but they're based in Jesus. What Jesus is suggesting to Nicodemus, who was he? A Pharisee. Rich tradition, not all of them were on the right track. He clearly is a man of a good heart. He's of the Jewish ruling council. He's the teacher of Israel. And what does Jesus say to him? You need to be born again. You need something that is not from the earth. You need something that is only from above, and you can only get it from above. In fact, it's like the wind. You can't generate it. You can experience it, but you can't make it happen. There is a life that can only happen with the Spirit. Jesus says, I came to give life so that you'd have it abundantly. John says, the only way to get it is through faith in Christ. So you understand, though you're alive, if you have not been twice born, you still have not experienced life. So what does this life look like? Sometimes we will ask the question, is this all there is to life? Do I have some purpose to fulfill, some greater kindness to give, some inner freedom to taste? The once-born person asks these questions but doesn't attend to them, says Tozer. He or she simply gets up the next morning and all the next mornings and lives as if the soul were a figment of our imagination. This inattention can make a person confused, numb, sad, or angry. But the twice-born person pays attention to the soul, pokes through the clouds of a half-lived life. Whether through choice or calamity, the twice-born person confronts that which needs to change within himself or herself to live a more genuine and radiant life. Now, this is not just first century talk. William James, the famous philosopher and psychologist, son of theologian Henry James and brother of the famous novelist Henry James, says this. In the midst of depression and terrific crisis of meaning, William James rediscovered free will and the ultimate meaning of the universe. He called his journey from crisis to meaning the twice-born life. In James's own experience, reflecting back on the famed author Leo Tolstoy, the Russian author, James writes about Leo Tolstoy's own restoration. He writes, the process of one is one of redemption, not a mere reversion to natural health. And the sufferer, when saved, is saved by what seems to him a second birth, a deeper kind of conscious being than he could enjoy before. So William James, this famed psychologist and philosopher, looking at his own crisis to meaning, says, it is a twice-born experience. Him reflecting on one of his own personal literary heroes, you know, the writer of, author of War and Peace and so on, writes that Leo Tolstoy's experience of moving from his great suffering to meaning was like a second birth. Leo Tolstoy, famous for War and Peace, later on wrote the book, The Kingdom of God is Within You. So here are these philosophers, these authors of a more recent century saying, no, this second birth thing, this isn't a thought of our imagination. This is real. And Jesus says to Nicodemus, whether you can figure it out or not, it is real, and you need to attend to the issues of the soul. Twice-born people use difficult challenges in their life to make inner changes in their life, while once-born people avoid or deny or bitterly accept the unpredictable changes of real life. The twice-born people use adversity for an awakening, allowing difficulty to initiate them into the deeper life of the Spirit. The journey from once-born to twice-born brings us to a crossroads where the old ways of doing things are no longer working, but the better, fuller life lies ahead. We may be afraid to go forward, but we're even more afraid to turn back. To turn back is one kind of death, but to go forward is another. The first kind of death ends in ashes, but the second leads toward rebirth. So Nicodemus says to Jesus, "You gotta be from God." Jesus says, "You're on the right track, but it's even deeper than you think." What it means is, I'm actually from above, and I'm inviting you to join me in this journey. Now, here's something fascinating. Most people are very familiar with John chapter 3. John 3, 5 is one of the most famous verses in the Bible about rebirth. But when you put it in the context, we get the story of Nicodemus. And again, many people are familiar with this story. But have you ever thought of why John has it in his book? John says, there's a lot I left out of this book. Not one wasted word. Why did I put the story of Nicodemus in it? I can tell you why. Number one, he wanted to relate how people came to faith face to face with Jesus. Number two, his first century Ephesian audience, they were in the same situation. John was presenting the life, the miracles, the teachings, the claims of Jesus to them. What would they do with it? Would they look at it just through an earthly view? Oh, some Jewish guy at the east end of the Mediterranean Sea. Or would they look at it through the heavenly view and be born from above? Then John wants us to do the same thing. Attend to the things of the soul, he says. Consider the claims of Jesus. And is he more than just a good, godly man? Well, John does more with Nicodemus, and we're going to complete our time in this session with two more passages in John that reveal the journey of Nicodemus. In John chapter 7, where we looked at in the last session that they sent the soldiers, the leaders, and the Pharisees, and the ruling council sent soldiers to arrest Jesus. The soldiers come back not only empty-handed, they come back with full hearts. They say, John 7:45, finally the temple guards went back to the chief priests and Pharisees, who asked them, "Why didn't you bring him in? No one ever spoke the way this man does," the guards declared. "You mean he has deceived you also?" the Pharisees retorted. "Has any of the rulers or of the Pharisees believed in him?" Any of the who? The ruling council. Any of the other? The Pharisees. What is their answer in verse 49? "No." Well, now wait a minute. What's Nicodemus? He's a member of the ruling council. What's Nicodemus? He's a Pharisee. What do the leaders who have charge of the meeting say? "Do any of us believe?" And what is their answer? "No." But watch what John does. Watch this. Verse 50. Nicodemus. Now, is this the same Nicodemus? Look at verse 50. Who had gone to Jesus earlier and who was one of their own number. So John wants us to know, this is the guy. This is the guy. This is Nick at night. He's the guy that asks, does our law condemn anyone without first hearing him to find out what he's doing? So notice, John gives us an update. So here's the first introduction to Nicodemus. You know, you got to be a man from God. You know, some of us have been talking. We've come to this conclusion, but I'm coming at night because it's kind of awkward. There's a lot of pressure on us. I still want to know who you are. Jesus says you got to be born again. The last thing we hear Nicodemus say is, how can this be? But then John says, don't abandon Nicodemus yet. Let me give you an update. Halfway through the gospel here, or about a third of the way through the story here, let me give you an update. In the middle of all of his peers, with all this pressure, them trying to arrest Jesus, and them resoundingly with a chorus saying, no, we don't believe. John says, watch Nick. Watch him. Maybe we should reconsider. Notice that John says to his Ephesian audience, that Asia Minor audience, and to you and me, you might be like Nick. No, okay, your first encounter with Jesus, you might think, I don't know if I believe or not. For some, this might be your first time studying the Bible in this way. This might be your first Bible class. It might be your first time through the book of John, and you're like, okay, I mean, I don't know how I feel about this. John says, I got it. I understand it. John says, I was like you. My first audience was like you. Nicodemus was like you. But he says, but notice as Nicodemus went along, he couldn't escape his experience with Jesus. He could no longer sit there idly by and just be like, okay, well, I'm not going to say anything. You see, Nicodemus realizes that comes a time in every person's life where you got to decide, what are you going to do with Jesus? What are you going to do with what you're learning about him? The miracles, the interactions with people, the claims, the fulfillment of prophecy. What are you going to do with him? And Nick says, I think we need to look into him more deeply. How do they respond? They put him down. They're furious. They persecute him. What do you think happened to some of the people in that early Ephesian audience? Or what still happens today? So you're one of those God people. Oh, so you're one of those people that, you know, they're like a Jesus freak. Oh, you're one of those Bible thumpers. We don't want any of those weird labels. And neither does Nicodemus, but what he understands is, either I'm going to ignore the things of my soul and ignore the things I'm learning about Jesus, or I'm going to risk being misrepresented. I'm going to miss being misunderstood. I'm going to miss being put down. But you know what? What I'm not going to miss out on is the opportunity to know the Son of God personally. He's not done. Look over at John 19. What I want you to see is John's final update on Nicodemus. In John 19, of course, obviously, Jesus has already been arrested. He's been on trial through the night, beaten, flogged. Eventually, he's crucified. And now, he's dead. Look with me at John 19 and verse 38. John 19, 38. Later, now this is after Jesus has already died on the cross. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate, that's the Roman governor, for the body of Jesus. Now pay close attention. Now Joseph of Arimathea, he was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jews. But with Pilate's permission, he came and took away the body, and he was accompanied by Nicodemus, Is this the same Nicodemus? I'm in verse 39. Look at it for yourself. Accompanied by Nicodemus, read it with me, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. What does John want us to see? That Nicodemus started out, he knew Jesus was from God, but when he figured out the implications of it all, it's kind of like, I don't know. That's chapter 3. We get the update partway through the ministry. Chapter 7, I think we better hear him out. What do we get in chapter 19? I'm all in. Notice it says, verse 39, Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Now, do you remember, real quickly, this is a little bit of a diversion, but I want to remind you of something. Do you remember when the wise men came to Jesus, the Bible lists three gifts. Do you remember that? Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Myrrh, interestingly enough, was used in the burial process because it was a kind of a would give off a scent that would cover or at least mask the smell of the dead body. As best of the research as I can find, there is at least once and perhaps twice in Egyptian history where myrrh was actually more valuable than gold. Twice. At least once, maybe twice. So that gives you an idea of how expensive this is, and it's 75 pounds. So this also gives us an idea of Nicodemus's financial capabilities, so his economic status. He is a leader, so he has economic status, political status, religious status. He's the teacher of Israel. You understand what John is doing? John is saying, here is a top guy, professionally, politically, educationally, religiously, culturally, and that guy, through a studied, thoughtful approach, said, I believe. John wants that Ephesian audience and those people in that audience who also may have one of those qualities of Nicodemus or all of those qualities of Nicodemus. John wants to say, do you realize that people just like you, with careful consideration, gave their lives to Jesus Christ? Notice it says, then Nicodemus accompanied him with a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds, took the body of Jesus, both of them. They wrapped it and with the spices and strips of linen. This was in accordance with the Jewish burial customs. And at the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid, because it was the Jewish day of preparation. And since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. Now, with me, I want you to look at how the other Gospels describe this situation. Write these down. Matthew 27, 57. It says that Joseph of Arimathea had become a disciple of Jesus. According to Luke, Luke 23, 50 to 52. Luke 23, 50 to 52. It says that he was a member, a prominent member of the Jewish ruling council, Joseph of Arimathea, that he was waiting for the kingdom. What did Jesus say to Nicodemus? If you want to see the kingdom. What was Nicodemus waiting for? For the kingdom. What was Joseph of Arimathea waiting for? For the kingdom. Is it possible that when Nicodemus said to Jesus, we know you're a man of God, he was talking about conversations he had had with Joseph of Arimathea. It also says in Luke that Joseph of Arimathea had not consented to the actions they took against Jesus. So while Nicodemus was willing to raise his hand and take a risk, Joseph wasn't ready to raise his hand yet. What does that teach us? It teaches us that even in the midst of a group like our class or like your friends, your family, there may be people right now considering faith, but they're not yet ready to raise their hand. They're not yet ready to give all to Jesus. But that doesn't mean they're not out there thinking, considering. Your witness to be gentle, thoughtful, engaging is so crucial. Here's the final statement. Mark tells us in Mark 15, 42 to 45, Mark 15, 42 to 45, that Joseph, and he repeats what the others say, good man, prominent member of the ruling council, the Bible says that Joseph, and now we know from John, accompanied with Nicodemus, went, and it says, they boldly asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Boldly. So when a man or a woman, a Nicodemus, a Joseph, when they are twice born, this is what the process looks like. You come to Jesus and he tells you, you're going to have to let go of life from here, just the tangible, and let those things point you to something greater. Give up living life for down below and live life for what's above. You must be twice born. And when you first hear that message, you might think, I don't understand how that can be. But as you continue to study, continue to learn, continue to allow the Spirit of God to work in your life, you finally think, I want to hear him out. And John says the ultimate is that the person that's twice born, even at the threat of death, will say boldly, give me Jesus. Twice born. I'm not sure where you are in the journey, but I hope that Nicodemus gives you some encouragement. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.